Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Frank Williams Show. And I'm your host, Frank Williams, where we talk about real issues. We showcase people in the trenches as well. And so my guest for the day is Mr. Rick Fortenberry. He is the executive director of Men and Women of Purpose. So how you doing, Mr. Fortenberry?
I'm doing well. I'm doing well, Mr. Williams. You know, thanks for having me on. I appreciate it. Give me the opportunity to talk about the work that we do.
Yes, sir. We wanted to have you on the show, you know, so you can sit here and talk about, tell the population, what is Men and Women of Purpose, how it got started,
okay.
Population that you serve.
Okay. So the population that we serve are people that's reentering back into our community from jails and institutions. Some prisons, mostly jails. AB 109, we deal with those type of clients, but for the most part, we deal with anybody that's reentering back into our community. We have a contract with the Sheriff Department in Contra Costa County. And, you know, our office is actually located in Richmond. We in West County, Contra Costa County.
Richmond, California.
Yes, sir. And so what we do is we have a team that goes in all three jails. There's three jails in Contra Costa County. We have one in Marsh Creek, Martinez, and West County Jail. So in the West County Jail, they keep the women and the men in there. So we have a team of women that goes in there and a team of men that go in there, and we do a 12-week curriculum with them and give them a certificate of completion, give them a chance and opportunity to do some job readiness, life skills, and stuff like that while they're in there. Then what we also do is we help them with driver's license while they're in there if they need ID, because that's one of the things coming home that we find out that some of the folks don't have in order to get employment, to get funds and stuff like that, is they don't have any ID.
Mm-hmm.
So we started that
process. So you help break some of the barriers, this whole, which we call criminogenic needs in the criminal justice system.
Okay.
But for our listeners out here, you know, we talk about breaking barriers that hold them back from achievement after they, while they're reentering into society.
Yeah, and Mr. Wayne, which is very important, because the opportunities are now are so much different than it was back in the older days. It wasn't as much services for folks coming home. So being that they don't have ID to get into these services is a barrier that most men and women coming home needs. And it was shocking to me because I didn't think it was that big.
So what about the other two jails? You was getting ready to tell us about the other two as
Yes. So the one up in Marsh Creek is where they have been sentenced already and they're doing their time. There we deal with the group. Their process is a little different because you know how long they're going to be there.
So they sentenced for quite a few.
Yeah.
A length of time. Okay.
So
you do in custody groups there.
Yeah. Do in custody groups, do some one-on-one.
Keep them mental, right?
Yeah, okay.
Keep the mind moving and stuff.
And you got to
right? Wake
them up, man.
Okay.
You got to wake
right.
them up. You got to wake that mind up because, you know, they get so relaxed and doing time that they become like robots and they thinking that whatever the jail tells them to do. They go back to their cell, eat at this time, do this at this time. If you don't give them some type of inspiration, some type of motivation about their lifestyle, that they can make some changes while they're here. So we change the way they think.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so they can change the behavior.
Mm-hmm.
Now I'm not gonna say everybody, you know, get a bar at this. You know what I mean? And what I mean by that is everybody's not ready at the same time.
Right.
That's why we got mentors.
That's right.
So when they come home, they may be ready. They might not been ready by then, but they may have heard something that triggered something, but they just wasn't ready at the time to make the move.
Right.
So that's why we have a mentor program. So we'll meet them at the gate, meet them at the door when they're getting ready to come home. You know, go with them to court, give them a letter going out, going to court, you know, letters of recommendation. If they need to go into a substance abuse treatment program, you know, mm-hmm. we'll help them with that.
Mm-hmm.
And
so what about the third jail that you was, what's that one about?
That's the Martinez jail.
Okay.
So in the Martinez jail, you got the people that's been fighting cases for like 10 years. You got a guy up there been fighting this case for 10 years. You got a guy been fighting cases for 7 years, 3 years, you know.
So they pre-sentenced. They not sentenced yet. They still going
yeah.
through court procedures and whatnot.
Yeah.
So what kind of services are they receiving while they're in there?
They wasn't.
They wow.
wasn't. That's the big thing. So we kind of like setting the ground for that. So we was able just, we just got in that jail. You know, the sheriff gave us that jail maybe 6 months ago.
That's so fascinating.
Yeah. So all the jails, you know, the jail system is different. The communication line is word of mouth. So if some one of the inmates or a convict speak about your program, mm-hmm. the word gets around, hey, that's the one you need to go to. That's mm-hmm. the one that's going to really help you, you know. So it got up to Martinez Jail. The word got up there. So they was requesting our services up there, and that's how we actually got in there, because they wouldn't have any service in there.
So you in the door.
We in the door.
So you in the door providing services. So you're providing direct and referral services to those that's incarcerated.
Yes. Yeah.
That's great. And so part of those services are the direct service that you go in and you do different groups, you do classes, you do individual counseling as well, correct?
Yeah.
And what you call mentoring as well, right?
Yes.
So what is the mechanism? I mean, or should I say, what is the procedure? Is that those that are involved in the classes are linked up with a mentor as well, so when they come out, they have somebody that's going to assist them at the gate?
Yes, that's real important, because what we call that is a soft handoff, meaning that once they come from jail, they see somebody that they already know that been coming into the jail, giving them information, giving them guidance, giving them positive reinforcement. Then we meet them at the gate and we take them to another program, another place, another employment place that will assist them, and we'll sit there with them and help them walk through that process. Mm-hmm. And so they feel comfortable about talking about where they came from, what they did, and what they're trying to do now. Mm-hmm. Because they understand now that things are getting ready to change for them. And that's what they've been wanting, but they just didn't know how to express it.
And so by providing them direct services as such, right, having that one-on-one contact, building a bond of communication between the case manager or the mentor that person, that inmate or convict,
right?
So it helped to increase their level of wanting change.
Yeah. Yes.
That speak big volumes, seeing that Richmond was once like the murder capital of California, correct?
Yes, sir.
So how do you feel about the changes that you help incorporate or your agency? How long, and before you answer that question, also, I'm going to follow that question up with, how long has Men and Women of Purpose been active?
Yeah. Thanks for the question. We've been active about 3 years. Me and a group of guys, some friends of mine, we all came together. We came together and we was saying that there were services out there, but they weren't for our folks, people that was coming home, criminals, right? Criminal backgrounds, people that the services that they needed, people that was doing the services are big programs. So they was more or less concerned about the numbers so they can be refunded again, and not really caring about the people that needed the service in our community, so our grandmothers can walk to the store, our kids can play at the park, so it'd be a safe community, and that's what we wanted. So based on the things that we knew, we all came together as a group, and we formed this group as Men and Women of Purpose. And what we did is we started off by just being in the park, passing out backpacks. We had an open mic. We give kids food and hot dogs and stuff like that. And then we start talking about the services that was in the community. And so what happened was that I was going to a meeting one day, and it was an AB-109 meeting back in 2011. And I seen the sheriff talking about his jail. And I asked him, can we go into your jail and do some of that work for free? We'd do it for free. So we went into jail and did this group work in the jail for free for a whole year. The following year, some money came out, 2012, and he dedicated all the funding and gave us our first contract, our very first contract.
Now, you keep using the acronyms AB-109. So for our listeners, what is AB-109?
That's a realignment. So what they did was they wanted the prisons to be not overcrowded. So what they did, people with nonviolent crimes, non-sex crimes, were able to go to the county and be on probation or then released from the jail because of the crime was charmed down. Can I say that? Mm-hmm. Lesser crime. So they were able to let them go, or they went to the county jail and it was on probation. They were no longer on parole, which is a big thing. Same client, just on probation now. So what happens is they call that the realignment, based on the fact that the prison population was overcrowded. Now that it's not overcrowded, now that the folks are able to get services through AB-109, because AB-109 has a money tag to it, and so the money that's tagged to it offers services into the community.
which is a great thing, right? For the non-violent, non-sexual, non-serious offenders, right?
Right, right.
That's a good thing. So, you know, I heard you touching a little something, so, you know, I have to keep it real, right?
Yeah, come on, sure.
So when you were sitting there talking about the services that wasn't really, because I read between the lines on that, there's services that wasn't really being given to this population, right?
Right.
And to the point that even the third jail was sending out requests asking you guys to come up in there because of word of mouth of what they've been hearing about the, you know, the type of work you've been doing.
Mm.
So, and you kind of tap danced around, you know, the finances, right? You know, about how the money was being used until, you know, you guys start demonstrating and advocating for a piece of that money because the money wasn't really being used for rehabilitation.
Right.
Am I putting words in your mouth? Am I kind of correct on that? You know?
Well, you know, you're a very intelligent man. Okay. Let me just say that first of all.
But, yes. it's happening now.
Yeah. The services are happening now. They are getting the services now. Yeah. But it was a time where folks that's been doing this work or say they're doing this work, you know, we're just collecting money for the numbers, per se, because it looked good on paper.
Mm-hmm.
But that's why people were still, recidivism was live, strong.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? That's why we dealing with it now, because they wouldn't give them no services at that time. Not no real service.
So, ladies and gentlemen, that's why we bring people on this show that's going to tell you the truth. You know what I mean? It's like, we already know those of us is in the trenches, but see, there's even those of us who are going to tell you even the truth about other programs is not really doing what they're supposed to be doing. So what he's here telling you about is the number game and how that's being played within the systems, and not only within the criminal justice system, within all systems, government, local government, but also between nonprofits as well. You know what I mean? So, but there's those of us who really care about the population that we work with, that we advocate seriously about this funding so we can go in and do the work. And not only that.
Come on, man. Talk
about
it.
Not only that.
Talk about it, dear.
We even volunteer and go in ahead of time to let them know just how serious we are to bring that services to them. Am I correct?
That is correct. Man, the chairman, Mr. Williams. Mr. Williams.
You call me the chairman.
Everybody I can call you
chair. By the chairman man, as well.
Hey, listen, man. You hit it right on the button, man. And like if we don't help these folks coming home, you know, our community got to be important to us. You know, I'm going to say just as black men, but just as men, period, in our community. You know, black and brown men have been treated differently for a long time. Now we're in a position not to be treated a certain kind of way because now we have a voice. Now we can speak up. There's people like you that's making a difference in our community just by having this show, right? So we can discuss what's going on. So black and brown, we are treated differently now. So because we have a voice, if we're at the table, we can speak on the policies, procedures. We can speak on those things. We can get those things in place for our people that fit our people. You know what I mean?
Well, let me ask you this question. What's your passion, man? What's your driver? Why are you doing this work?
Yeah.
Working with the incarcerated and formerly incarcerated. I mean, you know, a person with your background could be doing anything, even coaching kids in school, colleges to high schools. I mean, because I know you big with sports and children, you know. So why you working with the ones that society don't care about, man? I mean, you know, they don't care about no ex about community safety. They don't care about no ex offenders.
Wow.
Why do you care,
man? The chair. Listen, man. It's one thing I heard is the worst thing. What is there only one worst thing from being blind, and that's a man with sight with no vision. That's going to be the only thing worse than being blind. And your vision that you see, that you put out in the community, the things that you have done have inspired men across the Bay Area, the state of California. So vision has always been important to me as an individual. You know, watching men like you make progress. You know, I can name a few. George Turner, Doug McCoy. I can name a few other people that's making a difference, you know. But if a man don't have a vision, a passion for something, he'll go for anything. And, you know, I'm not finna go all the way back to the Black Panther days and all that stuff. I mean, that was a time for, you know, that, you know. But now it's different. We need video. We got technology now. You know what I mean? You know, the look. I mean, if you get a good look at the chairman, the tie, he's not sagging. You know, so we got to present. So what's my point? My passion, sir, is this, is that I once was that. You know, I had to change my life. I was forgotten about. I was left in them cells on those blocks, walking those yards. Nobody cared. Deep down the inside, I wanted to change something. You know, I grew up without a dad and all that. You know what I mean? So I didn't know about relationships or nothing. I didn't know how to keep all that. So it was real important to me to figure something out in life for myself. You know, look, most of us, we taught ourselves. You know, we went to school for stuff. And I know you went back to school, but a lot of things, Chairman, you taught yourself. You figured this, you say, I got to figure this out.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
You got to figure this out.
Most definitely.
You know, you have your master's, you work on your master's?
I got two master's. But it ain't about me. It's about you, Rick. Let them know about your passion, man.
Hey, so I push off and I strive off of that, though. You know, it's we got to acknowledge each other. Like you giving me this opportunity to talk to me, but you got to talk about the chairman, too, because we are the ones that's bridging the gap, and we have to be looked at a certain kind of way, which I mean is from our black and brown brothers. You got to look at us and say, hey, these guys came from jail, from prison, and look, they trying to make a change. So you guys got to get on board and try to help support what we're trying to do. So my passion is that so we can have a safe passage on our way home, like, because I didn't have one. Mm-hmm. When I came home, I went back to the jungle, the hood. It was mm-hmm. bad. It was all bad.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? It wasn't all these services. It wasn't like that. Mm-hmm. It was one service at that time when I came home. It called Base In. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And that was the only thing. It had just came out. It was new, and everybody was getting it. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But anyway, so now there's plenty of services. And now I think as men, we deserve a second chance for a first-class life. You know what I mean? So we've been through it. We had the experience. We got the education now. Now pay us for what we worth. You know, give us what we worth, right? You're going to give it to the department heads, the probation, right? All right? You're going to give it to the parole agents. You're going to even the county folks, right? They're going to get the money. They're going to make policies and procedures. And they're going to sit behind the desk. But they ain't going to never walk into a jail cell, never walk into a jail room. They ain't never going to walk to the trenches, to the block. They're not going to tell, hey, man, pull your pants up. They don't know what that's like. Won't they give us the money and then let us pay the police department? Let us pay them. Let them to get the community-based program, CBOs, the money, and let us deal it out. Well, we don't need to make this man arrest. You need to go let this person get counseling. We're going to pay counseling. We're going to pay for counseling. But we're still going to pay for the policing. But we need, as a community, we need to learn how to police ourselves. Right? Not in a way that we take each other to jail or not take each other to jail, but way to say, hey, this behavior is going to cost your family, your loved ones, everybody to be incarcerated with you at the same time, or in your addiction, in your alcohol. They got to suffer through this at the time. They're not going to have a fair shot at the American pot.
Man, I hope you guys are really listening to this conversation, because it's more deeply than it sounds, right? I mean, it's more in depth in the way it's really sounding right now, because, you know, you done touched quite a few different things, you know, from safety to economics. So let's talk about community safety. I mean, you spoke about early that I heard you talk about recidivism and why it's still so high. Mm. You know, there's in the news, I think just yesterday morning, where they talked about, you know, crime is really going down, right?
Mm-hmm.
Crime is going down. The amount of people incarcerated has been dropping. San Francisco has been in the forefront as far as collaboration between the district attorney office and them with pre-trial, making sure that those people get some services right now.
Okay.
San Francisco Department Defender Office, I mean, they really standing for it and making sure that some of these people getting trumped up charges not get prosecuted. As far as San Francisco Sheriff Department, I mean, we are the lowest stats in California. Now, I mean, it didn't drop down. I don't even think it's 1,000 people incarcerated, maybe, in San Francisco.
Mm.
But mm-hmm. still, there's this other thing that's still hanging over, though. With all of these stats dropping, African Americans are still the highest incarcerated.
Mm.
How do you feel about that, Rick, in this business that you're doing, going in there working with this population? Is there another barrier that's not being talked about, that the recidivism is still high with black and brown people, black specifically?
Mm-hmm.
Is this something that's not being given to them? What you think?
I think everybody, if you talk to any CPA or any bank folks, HR department, they tell you how they can always fudge a number. They can always massage a number, make a number look the way that the community wants to see it. I'm not saying that these folks are doing that, but if you actually look at the folks that's coming home from jail, they're black and brown. And what's even more alarming is now is that our black women, black female, that number is getting bigger and larger every time. You're right, there's a lot non-discussion about that, right? So every community, and county, it's like 58 counties in the state of California, and everybody's trying to apply for some money. So keyword recidivism, budget lines, so they all trying to match that in different counties, the department heads and stuff, and try to get the funding for their departments. And so they'll say what it is that they need to say. But the reality of it is, if you look at our streets, if you look at the news, what do the news say?
Mm-hmm.
Right? Everybody say everybody lives matter, but when you look at the news, this black man getting shot. He ain't got a gun. He had, his telephone always looked like a gun.
And that's sad, right?
Yeah.
But, I still think that these stats are alarming. And, what it says to me is that there's not enough services going in to serve the people. And just listening to what you were saying about the county that you're in, Contra Costa County, the three jails that you're providing services in, and how word of mouth had to like really come to a high pitch tone for them to even recognize, give you the recognition that your agency, the recognition deserve,
right,
in order for you to start providing additional services to those who are in there hungry for knowledge,
man.
Thirsty for knowledge, man. I mean, it's like what people don't understand about these people that are incarcerated is that, man, for the most part, a lot of them didn't ask to do wrong. A lot of them made mistakes.
Right.
You know what I mean? A lot of them made mistakes because of the circumstance they was in, and there's many variables for making mistakes.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And then there's many variables of mistakes done on the other end as well, such as not having a pipeline from high school to employment, right? Having a rise in employment. But if you really break down the stats and the rise of employment, it's low for African Americans.
Right.
See, and we don't look at that. So when the news say, employment has risen, who has it risen for?
Wow.
So if you bring in all these different, say, tech companies, man, and now unemployment went up, say, 7.4%, and they trying to make it look like it's general when it's not general, but it's really white America who are qualified for those jobs,
right,
where African Americans may not be qualified for those jobs or may be qualified but looked over because they don't have the look. So then what do? And it's like, it's like deviance is everywhere. Deviance is going to happen. Deviance going to happen regardless. You know what I mean? But why they're incarcerated is the most opportunistic time to provide them a way,
right,
and for people such as yourself to come in and social model,
mm-hmm,
positive behavior,
because
what you said earlier about changing the mind in order to change behavior, you can't change the behavior. You can hold them and lock them down. That's not changing the behavior.
Mm-mm.
You could take a wild dog, throw him in the cage. That don't tame him down, because soon you open that cage, I'll let that dog, he gonna bite you.
Gonna tear up everything,
right? So, that's what made me ask you about your passion and about doing this work, because I commend you for the work that you and your team is doing, men and women,
out there
in the community of Richmond, throwing barbecues for those who are out. And not only that, see, ladies and gentlemen, he's talking about the giveaways of backpacks and all of them, and that's not to the incarcerated. That's to the community. To the community, to those children from families who really don't have the money for that, right?
They don't have the money.
They struggling. They got to make a decision if they're going to pay their PG&E or buy that child a backpack for school.
Yeah.
Am I correct?
You're right.
So, what I want people to understand when I bring people on here that's in the trenches,
right?
You know what I mean?
Right.
We may have specific population that we're working with,
mm-hmm,
But we work with everybody, don't we?
We work with everybody. We got to work with everybody. I mean, because like you said, it's our passion. We want our folks to have a chance at this life. Back when I was going through the system, you know, a vacation to me was when I went to another jail, from another prison, got on the bus. I had never left my own community, man.
Wow.
You know, left the block.
Right.
You know what I mean? So we got to wake them up. It's people out here who's going to Disneyland. It's people going to Florida, going to Hawaii.
Right.
They live in.
What it look like.
Yes.
They don't know.
No, not just getting out of your cell, going to the block, walking around, going around the yard.
Right.
No. We doing it out here. We changed it.
Institutionalization is real big, you know, and if we could really like break it down just a little bit, you know, we can look at how even we were set up to go to school inside of an institution.
Mm.
Huh?
What?
We was inside them walls, man, and you were structured. You had to be there from 8 to 3, and it was things you had to do, and when that bell ring, you got up like cattle, you went to the next room, right?
What?
Same thing in them prisons, right?
Right.
It's count time.
Wow.
Y'all raise your hand, can you use the restroom, right?
Wow.
Because if you move too fast, they lock and load on you, they ready to shoot you, right?
Oh, yeah.
You know, and then next you know, it's time to go to chow hall, right?
Man.
You got to walk in line. I mean, and then when you go to the hospitals, it's what? The same thing.
The same
when
thing?
When you sit in them hospitals, what happened, man? You sitting it over there, you stand in line.
What?
Right?
You yep.
Giving them your identification.
Right.
Same thing. Same. Them papers, right? I'm just keeping it 100.
Come over there.
Right?
Come on, Chairman.
Then you got to sit down again, and then you got to wait till that dance for that number to even show up or that buzzer to ring with your number up there. Bing, number 11. You got to get up. I mean, think about the mindset of institutionalization, man.
Wow.
It's so strong.
Wow.
And so, you know, to be primed.
That's deep.
To be within an institution.
Yeah.
You end up serving your life within these institutions,
yeah.
man.
Yeah.
And see, and that's our job, to go in there and break that conditioning, man.
Yeah.
So tell us some of the pro. First of all, I want you to tell them, where can they reach you at?
Yeah.
Tell them where your program is located at.
Yeah. Yeah, so we located in Richmond off of 30th and McDonald, Richmond, California. The number there is 510-243-7545. You can go to our website, www.mwpurpose.org, and you can call and contact us, and we assist you with whatever we can and whenever we can. Someone will always be there for you.
So for those of you that's in Contra Costa County and have people who are incarcerated or formerly incarcerated that need services, make sure you contact Men and Women of Purpose. Get a line through to Rick Fortenberry or his staff and let them know what your cause is for your reason for calling and the type of services that you may need and information that you may need within that community, because it's important that we reach everyone that we can, and that's, you know, we in this trenches, you know. And I'm very proud of this man right here.
Yeah. Can I ask you a question, sir?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. You know, I know everybody already know this to the chairman, but you always inspired me as a young black male, and there's some things that you do. Can you drop some lines for us? You drop me a verse, because I you keep me motivated, man.
All right.
Can you drop something for me?
He wanted to hear the chairman's side, right? Okay.
Let him know why we're here for real, bro.
Okay, I'll give you the signature if you want the signature one, right?
Yeah.
All right. So my body's too heavy to hang from a tree. My mind is too deep to be brainwashed against humanity. My shoulders are too strong to give up on life behind issues. My arms are too strong. My legs are too strong. My desires are too strong to give up on you and me. For I am one of the seeds created to be. For I am one of the ones sent forth to awaken dead eyes, to motivate forsaken souls and share knowledge with those who are lost. Open the minds and encouraging the vulnerable, the abandoned, and the despondent so that they will rise. Rise above their issues. Rise above the surface of social ills. Rise above the agenda of a worn-out paradigm, a conditioned belief, a conditioned ideologies that causes one to be left without confusion and disbelief, you see.
Mm.
My body's too heavy
to
hang from a tree.
Mm.
Is that good for you?
Oh, man. Come on, sir. Come on, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Hey, you know, we call him the chairman, but I had to call this man the sir. Yes, sir. I have to say yes, sir. Hey, you know, and so you guys can see. Come on, man. This is what we, how we inspire. You know, this is the chairman, right? So this is what makes us grow. This is how steel sharpens steel, mind sharpens mind. This is how we don't forget. This is how we motivate, because we got to wake the dream up. We can't let you stay asleep. And then when you get up, we can't let you leave your dream still on the pillow. Talk about, I'm going to cover you up, dream. I'm going to go over here, walk on the yard, sell me some drugs over here. I come back, I'm going to pick up my dream. We're not doing that no more. We want you to dream. We want you to be inspired. And everybody can't do what he just did, but that's inspiration. What I'm saying is that will keep me motivated. You know, that's what keep me going. And that's what we need. I mean, you know, for the love of God, I mean, can I speak?
Speak.
Yeah, man, for the love of God, for the grace of God, I wouldn't be here today. I mean, the things that I've seen, the things that I experienced, God made all this possible. Don't ever forget. You can call you God whatever you want to call him. I'm not even tripping off of that. I love God. I love Jesus. I love the Son of Christ. That's who I love. You got to have a belief system, something you can connect to. It's not going to say it's busy, disconnected. Something that you can connect to at some of your roughest time and at some of your best times. So always get grace and humbly thank God. And because this is a humbling moment for me to be here with the chairman. And I just pray that God continue to embrace you, inspire you, and prosperity for whatever you touch from this day forward, my brother. Yes, sir. Thank you.
I appreciate you, man. And you know I got nothing but love for you. Rick, and the wonderful work you're doing, man.
Thanks, Frank.
You know, and that's why we want to highlight you and showcase you.
Mean a lot to me. Thank you.
You know what I mean? And we want the public to really get out and know who you are so they can support you. So please support men and women of purpose out there in Contra Costa County, Richmond, California. And that's about it for our show for today. So once again, we want to welcome Mr. Rick Fortenberry for being here today.
Thank you.
Wow, we've seen him grow a whole lot, and his program is growing. So please support men and women of purpose in Richmond, California. And not only that, support somebody. Just love somebody. And that's what we're here to do, is love, look, you know, to get this love out there. And most of all, love yourself. And if nobody tells you they love you today, I love you. Good night.
Open my mind with the truth, Jeremy. Open my mind with the truth. Open my mind with the truth now.